The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is the lead federal agency for the project. They are also the lead federal agency for the National Environmental Policy Act, NEPA. The Central Valley Flood Protection Board is the lead state agency for the California Environmental Quality Act, or CEQA. The board, the Department of Water Resources, and local government agency, the Sacramento Area Flood Control Agency, are the non-federal partners for the ARCF 2016 project. Next slide. So the ARCF 2016 project not only includes the projects that we'll be discussing today, there are many other portions. The 2016 Final General Reevaluation Report, EIS EIR, was authorized in WERDA, the Water Resources Development Act of 2016, and the Construction Authority, which provided funding for this project, was passed in 2018 under the Bipartisan Budget Act. Next slide. So I wanted to present to you the greater study and project purpose that began in 2016 and is still the purpose of this project today. Generally, the purpose is to address the seepage, slope stability, erosion, and height concerns on the levees along the Sacramento and American rivers to improve flood risk management in the Sacramento metropolitan area. Sacramento is located within a natural floodplain due to the confluence of the American and Sacramento rivers, and is actually one of the most at-risk cities in the entire nation for catastrophic flooding. As you can see in this photo of the river, this occurred in 1986. It was a pretty serious erosional event in the River Park neighborhood, which is just adjacent to the I-80 bridge, and it nearly became a catastrophic flood. There is an unacceptably high risk of flooding from levee failure that threatens the public safety of over 500,000 people and nearly 100,000 structures, including homes. The hydraulic modeling completed for the 2016 study, which you can see in these figures on the right and left, demonstrated that flooding could reach a depth of over 20 feet in some areas and cause up to $4 billion in damages, which is an enormous economic disaster that would impact the local, state, and federal economy. So that dollar amount is actually in 2016 value, so that does not consider inflation to today in 2024. Now, since the 2016 study, the Folsom Joint Federal Project, JFP Auxiliary Spillway, was completed, which increased the maximum outflow from Folsom Lake to 160,000 cubic feet per second. The current and ongoing Folsom Dam Raise project is increasing storage capacity, and that combined with increased flow requires levee and infrastructure improvements throughout the downstream levee network. Increased spills from Folsom lead to higher water surface elevations in the river channel, higher velocities due to the constricted levee system, and substantially increases the risk of levee erosion that could ultimately lead to levee failure. Levee failure has the potential to lead to immediate loss of life and injury to people in neighboring communities, as well as health and public safety concerns associated with flood damages, including lack of electricity, clean water, or access to emergency care. Next slide. After the ARCF 2016 project was authorized by Congress, USAIS began the detailed design. River surveys were completed by boat with visual inspections of each river reach. Reaches were ranked by current status, and included levels of existing erosion. Geotechnical and soil sampling was conducted. Following that visual ranking, afterwards, reaches were grouped into projects, and projects were then prioritized based on their constructability and sequence to provide flood risk reduction benefits to communities with the highest life safety risk and most costly flood-related damages. As you can see, there are several projects that have already been completed. Some of these include the Sacramento River East Levee SREL, Seepage Stability Overtopping Project. We have the Sacramento Weir and Bypass Widening Project, which is under construction now. And please note that all of the prior environmental documentation for already constructed contracts is available on the website, sacleveeupgrades.com, which will be provided later. Next slide. So the need for this supplemental environmental impact statement, subsequent environmental impact report, we'll refer to it as the SEIS, SEIR, is needed to analyze the design refinements that have occurred since the 2016 GRR EIS EIR was finalized. In the past 8 years, there have been design refinements to the following project components, including American River Erosion Contract 3B, 4A, and 4B, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3, the Magpie Creek Project, American River and Sacramento River mitigation sites, and a piezometer network. Some of these design refinements include changes to the scope, location, design, or construction details. These refinements resulted due to new engineering data, such as the geotechnical investigations, hydraulic modeling, improved technology and research, updates in federal, local, and state, and even levee safety policy, and environmental compliance regulations. For example, new executive orders that have been passed regarding climate change, greenhouse gases, and environmental justice. We expect that the record of decision and the CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act certification, will occur late summer or fall of this year. Next slide. I want to direct your attention to the map so that you can identify all of the separate project components. They are all within Sacramento County. We will start on the American River. As you can see towards the east, American River Erosion Contracts 3B North and 3B South, they're in pink and orange. Also, American River Erosion Contract 4B is in blue. If you go downstream, there is a yellow polygon that is American River Erosion Contract 4A. And even further downstream towards the confluence of the Sacramento River is the American River Mitigation Site in red. If we go north, just north of Sacramento, you will see a brown line. That's the Magpie Creek Project. If we go back to the Sacramento River and we go south into the Pocket neighborhoods, we will find Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3, those two green lines along levees. Further south and in that separate box is the Sacramento River Mitigation Site, and that's the little purple triangle, and it's along along the Sacramento River and down towards the Delta. So the intent of this report that we're presenting today is to present you the proposed project with alternatives, describe the alternative selection process, to demonstrate that the analyzation of the short and long-term impacts associated with the project, including human, physical, ecological, and biological, and cultural resources. Additionally, we will describe if significant impacts arose, and in the document, we propose mitigation measures that can be implemented prior, during, or after construction. Next slide. So I want to briefly go over these design refinements by project component, and they will be discussed in detail just after I'm done. So I'll start with American River. There's a variety of contracts, and the reason that we included this in this document, this SEIS, SEIR, is because we have refined the erosion protection methods to include a launchable tow protection. This erosion protection method is used to provide better on-site mitigation, fisheries habitat, and actually decreases the impacts to the heritage oak trees. It also, we've refined the haul routes and staging areas. We've added a contract due to new hydraulic modeling to better protect the State Route 160 bridge from severe erosion due to high velocity in the river channel. And these refined designs also require more rock and soil materials. Additionally, the contract on the Sacramento River, similarly, we have refined the erosion protection methods for the launchable tow protection to provide better on-site mitigation. There's been new identification of landside staging areas. Additionally, the 2016 document originally assumed that work would be completed in the river by barge. Now we will be operating with construction equipment on the river shoreline. Similar to the American River, these refined designs require more soil and rock material. Next slide. The Magpie Creek Project to the north of Sacramento includes the levee extension, widening, and realignment of a portion of the Magpie Creek diversion channel. Additionally, this project will include culverts beneath the Sacramento River bike trails, new flowage easements to allow for water retention upstream of Rayleigh Boulevard. There will be night work and a full road closure at Rayleigh Boulevard for a portion of construction. The piezometer network was not described in the 2016 EIS EIR, and this includes a groundwater data collection system that will be implemented after construction to monitor the levee improvement performance. The mitigation sites have been further designed than were presented in the 2016 documents. The American River mitigation site is about 120 acres. It'll be newly constructed, and that exists in the American River Parkway. There are the species and habitats here that we will get into detail further in the slides. The Sacramento River mitigation site will be also about a newly constructed mitigation site, about 200 acres. It's located at Grand Island on the Sacramento River near the confluence of the Cache and Steamboat Sloughs. The listed species and habitats that we will be constructing to provide habitat for are listed here. Like I said, we'll get into the details further on. Now I'll let my colleague, Ms. Bailey Hunter, discuss the details of the American River Erosion Contracts 3B, 4B, and 4A, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3, and the Magpie Creek Project. She'll be starting off with American River Erosion Contract 3B, which has one of the highest risks of levee failure and risk to life safety in the region, and is a number one priority for UCA Sacramento District.
Hello, my name is Bailey Hunter. I work for the Army Corps. I'm going to go over some of the projects and the environmental impacts that our team found when we did our analysis. I'm going to start on the American River with American River Erosion Contract 3B. This is an erosion project. It's technically actually made up of two contracts, 3B North and South. 3B North is made up of Site 31, which is in between Howe Avenue and Watt Avenue on the north side of the river, and Site 42, which is between Watt Avenue and kind of the Rio Americano School area. 3B South is made up of 41, which is from just downstream of Watt Avenue to the Mayhew Drain. 3B is made up of a bunch of different types of erosion protection measures that we picked site by site in very specific locations to try and minimize the environmental impacts as much as possible. We have levee and riverbank bank protection, which is placing soil-filled rock over the ground, placing a little bit of soil on top so we can plant. We have buried launchable trench, which is essentially buried revetment. So as the riverbank erodes away, eventually it'll hit that buried revetment, which will launch and stop further. It's buried so we can plant on top of it. We got launchable toes, which is putting kind of a back of revetment in the river, which allows us to have planting benches behind it, and as the riverbank erodes, it'll launch and stop further erosion. Right next to contract 3B is contract 4B, and basically when the design team was doing their analysis, they determined that there are some trees right next to 3B that are at risk of what we're calling lone tree scour, which essentially is trees kind of by themselves that are pretty big, and at certain velocities, the eddies kind of the water kind of go around the tree and erode away around the base of the tree, which puts the levee at risk. So 4B is looking at different measures like placing gravel or placing revetment, or in some cases having to cut down the tree to prevent that erosion from occurring. The work is one location is on the north side of the river, just downstream of Watt, and one location is on the south side of the river, just downstream of Larchmont Park. Next slide, please. The environmental impacts that we found are listed below. One is recreation. All the projects in the American River Parkway we will be disrupting during construction and staging, which is going to impact people wanting to recreate. For transportation and circulation, we're going to be adding a lot of haul trucks to local roads. For environmental justice, those haul trucks are going to pass through disadvantaged communities. For aesthetics and visual impacts, the vegetation we have to remove to install the erosion features will decrease the visual character of the area until we're able to get the plants and trees to reestablish. For water quality, we found that some trees that might be removed near the water's edge could increase the water temperature until vegetation reestablishes. For air quality and climate change, there It was determined there's high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions from the haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, the levees are pretty close to homes, so high noise levels from construction could disrupt sensitive receptors. And by sensitive receptors, we mean people living in their homes or people recreating and wanting to enjoy the kind of pristine area, that kind of stuff. For vegetation, wildlife, fisheries, and special status species, we fortunately have to do habitat removal and disturbance in order to install our erosion protection features. Though, as I mentioned, we are going to be replanting. Next slide, please. The other erosion project on the American River is American River Erosion Contract 4A. It is on the north side of the river, just upstream of State Route 160. This map makes it look like it's a really big project, but actually the erosion features is just a small berm just next to the bridge. The problem is, and that berm is a velocity diversion berm. So the risk at this site is erosion from velocities, but also a major risk is erosion from pier scour. So similar to what I was saying about lone tree scour, the eddies at certain velocities kind of go around the pier and scour away, risking putting the levee at risk for failure. So we are proposing to build a berm that would deflect those velocities away. Problem is, the location where that berm needs to be is on top of the Jedediah Smith Memorial Trail. So we're having to do a permanent reroute of the memorial trail in order to install this work. So a lot of that stuff you're seeing on the map is actually the reroute to allow recreation to continue. Next slide, please. So as I mentioned, a big recreational impact is that the erosion features are going to block the memorial trail, and we're having to do a reroute in the floodplain. But additionally, we are still in the American River Parkway, so we are going to be disrupting during construction. For transportation and circulation, similar to Contract 3B and 4B, we are adding haul trucks to local roads. For air quality and climate change, we found high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, this is a high recreational area, so the noise could disturb recreationalists. Vegetation, wildlife, and special status species, we are having to do habitat removal in order to install the erosion features and a little bit in order to install the bike trail reroute. Unfortunately, because of the location of the diversion berm, it is in the veg-free zone, so we can't replant the site with woody vegetation. So we would be planting grasses and maybe some forbs. And in addition, we are kind of adjusting the topography for that bike trail reroute, which there's a possibility we could risk increasing fish stranding at the site. Next slide, please. For 4A, we looked at a few different alternatives. So the very first map you're seeing is the proposed alternative. The second map, alternative 3A, would be a landside berm. It would have similar impact to the proposed action, except for there'd be less vegetation, wildlife, fish, special species, habitat impacts, less recreational impacts, less resource impacts, and no impact to risk of fish stranding. Alternative 3B would be a similar bike trail reroute, except for instead of going under the railroad and connecting further down, we would shoot up parallel to the railroad and connect back to the bike trail just past the berm. That is similar to the proposed action, except there'd be slightly lower impact to the overall habitat, but slightly higher impact to special species habitat. Alternative 3C would be instead of going into the floodplain for a bike trail detour, we would have the bikes go around the berm. However, we'd still need a temporary detour for folks to get around during construction, so we would still have to impact those areas. It would have a similar impact to the proposed action, except for higher impact on veg, wildlife, fish, and special status species, so there'd be a lower impact to the risk of fish stranding. Alternative 3D would have a longer
bike trail detour or reroute, which would go further down into the floodplain and be similar to the proposed action, except for it'd have a higher impact on veg, wildlife, and special status species. Next slide, please. Now we're moving on to the Sacramento River. So this is the only erosion project on the Sacramento River in this environmental document, Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3. It is along parts of the pocket neighborhood. So you see in the first map, that's on the northern part, and the other map is on the southern part. 3B is a mixture of kind of revetment being placed at grade and launchable tow, which I kind of talked about with 3B as well, and then some tiebacks. You'll notice in these maps, there's a lot less access, and that is because the materials for construction are being brought in by barges instead of haul trucks.
Good. That's good.
So there are some aesthetic and visual impacts due to vegetation removal, which would decrease the visual character along the area. For water quality, removal of trees along the riverbank could increase the water temperature. For air quality and climate change, we found high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with barges and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, we are near neighborhoods, so there would be high noise levels that could disrupt sensitive receptors. For vegetation, fish, wildlife, and special status species, habitat removal and disturbance is required for installation of the erosion protection features. Next slide, please. And then we have Magpie Creek Project, which is along the Magpie Creek Diversion Channel. If you're unfamiliar, it's kind of north of Sacramento, kind of near Rio Linda. If you're familiar with the jet or the water ski school, you can see the big ponds just north of the project. You'll also see Rayleigh Boulevard on the right. So this project is a mixture. So the other projects we talked about were erosion. This project is seepage instability. It's a mixture of widening the channel, modifying the channel, extending the levee, and installing some culverts under Rayleigh Boulevard and the bike trail. Next slide, please. So the environmental impacts. We are constructing, as I mentioned, some culverts under the Sacramento North Northern Bike Trail. So we're going to require some detours for transportation and circulation. Rayleigh Boulevard would be closed for work, and it's going to require some traffic detours. In addition, trucks will be added to local roads. Environmental justice, those haul trucks would be going through some disadvantaged communities. For water quality, construction could cause short-term water quality issues once water is reintroduced to the new and wider channel. So basically, we're going to go in and kind of dig out the channel, make it wider, but we're going to be stirring stuff up. So once we reintroduce water back into that channel, all that stuff we've kind of stirred up is going to be pushed out. So it'd only be a water quality impact right when we reintroduce water back in. For air quality and climate change, we saw high NOx and greenhouse gas emissions associated with haul trucks and construction equipment. For noise and vibration, there are some homes in the area, so there'd be high noises that could disrupt sensitive receptors. For hydraulics and wetlands, there are impacts to wetlands east of Rayleigh Boulevard. And in addition, it was found that there's a downstream stage increase just upstream of the Northern Bike Trail on Rubble Creek due to increased Magpie Creek Diversion Channel capacity during high events larger than 7% AEP.
Hi everyone, I'm Nikki Schleter, and I'm going to switch gears slightly and move away from the bank improvements to mitigation. As we all know, the Supplemental Environmental Impact Statement is the umbrella document to show compliance with all environmental laws. Some of those laws require mitigation, which can take many forms, but I'm going to focus on species and habitat mitigation. The site design teams start with the entire study area, identifying the need, which Kelly so clearly laid out at the beginning, the risk, and then we narrow in on locations that need the work. Then as they design the repair work, the overall footprint shrinks in size. These steps are known as avoiding and minimizing necessary impact. Then the unavoidable impact, first on site as much as possible, and then off site. Repair works is designed to incorporate native vegetation to the maximum extent possible. which can look like buried rock trenches, soil-filled riprap, laying back banks for softer slopes, and including bioengineering. All of these methods allow vegetation to grow back on site. Once construction is finished and the vegetation is planted, it will be irrigated and maintained for a few years to ensure that it will continue to grow and recreate the habitat that has been disturbed. The photograph on the right shows an example of older repair sites done on the Lower American River. It started in May of 2001 with some basic plantings and rock revetment at the bottom of the levee slope. And then over time, you can see how the vegetation grew back in, creating the riparian corridor that we're familiar with today over by Guy West. Next slide. Now, unfortunately, not all of our habitat mitigation can be completed within the repair footprint, which requires the project partners to go outside of the construction footprint and identify locations suitable for replacing the lost habitat and functions and services. This next site is on the Sacramento River. It's the Sacramento River Mitigation Site, or SRMS for short. The site is strategically located at the confluence of Cache Creek Slough, the Sacramento River, and Steamboat Slough, right on the migratory corridor for all of our listeners. Currently, the land is upland habitat, but after the mitigation project will be completed, it's going to provide habitat and a food source for Chinook salmon, Delta smelt, and green sturgeon by reconnecting the floodplain habitat to the river. Then appropriate native vegetation will be planted around the higher elevation to ensure there's stopover habitat for a migratory bird. Next slide. The environmental impacts are all resulting from the construction and creating the new habitat, such as water quality turbidity when we're connecting the river to the constructed site, greenhouse gas emissions associated with equipment moving the material around on site and carving out our channels, and there'll also be some visual impact to the folks driving along Highway 160. You can see the Grand Island site from across the river. Next slide. Multiple alternatives were considered to this mitigation site and eliminated before the document took shape. The alternatives that remain are the purchase of mitigation credits for all mitigation requirements for all species. The next is purchasing a different plot of land and constructing connected floodplain habitat elsewhere on the Sacramento River and doing a combined bank credit purchase for anything that we're not able to construct. Lastly is a combination project focusing on one of National Marine Fisheries Service recovery projects combined with purchasing mitigation credits. Each of these has their own pros and cons, and they're discussed further in the document. And here we're showing the American River Mitigation Site, or ARMS. The site is located next to Discovery Park on the north bank of the Lower American River. Currently, the area consists of man-made ponds surrounded by managed uplands with a fringe of riparian habitat. After the mitigation project, it will be a connected floodplain that is inundated year-round at different water elevations, providing rearing habitat and food sources for Chinook salmon and steelhead. The newly adjusted elevations will be planted with appropriate native vegetation, which will allow stopover habitat for migratory birds, a corridor for all of the wildlife that currently exists in the Lower American River, and will create some elderberry savanna habitat around the highest elevation, targeting mitigation for all of our endangered species. Next slide. So there's quite a few environmental impacts associated with this one. Very similar to the Sac River mitigation site, the greenhouse gas emissions and noise from equipment moving dirt. There'll be some water quality impact when we connect the channels to the river. And there will also be temporary impacts to the visual aesthetics and recreation. We will have some trail impacts. Folks using the parkway for recreation and using the river for recreation will be able to see the construction occurring. Lastly, this site is well known for its cultural significance to local tourists. Next, I'm going to hand it over to Mr. Josh Brown, and he's going to talk about our alternatives.
Good evening. My name is Josh Brown. I'm with the California Department of Water Resources Division of Flood Management, Flood Projects Branch. During scoping, written comment was received from the Sacramento County Department of Regional Parks. Regional Parks requested that an alternative for the American River mitigation site that retained a portion of the existing pond be considered. Regional Parks provided a specific conceptual design in their comment letter. The alternative design proposed by Regional Parks was included and analyzed as alternative 4A in SEIR and is shown in the upper left side of this slide. Although Regional Parks identified the alternative as requiring little or no soil import, subsequent investigations of the ARM site indicated that much of the soil material on site is unsuitable for reuse. So the assumption for soil import and export were adjusted in the SEIR alternative 4A. Based on this newer information, alternative 4A would modestly reduce the soil handling that would be required as part of the proposed action, reducing transportation, air quality, greenhouse gas impacts, but still not avoiding significant impacts in these topic areas. Additionally, several sensitive resources and habitats located on the site, including an eagle's nest, were not well known at the time that Regional Parks proposed the conceptual design that became alternative 4A. After further analysis, it was determined that the proposed design would directly impact the eagle's nest that is located on the site. To avoid impacts on these sensitive resources under alternative 4A, while still analyzing an alternative that would retain a portion of the pond, DWR and the Central Valley Flood Protection Board included alternative 4B in the SEIR. Alternative 4B, illustrated on the right side of the slide, was developed during the USACE design process to retain a portion of the pond, reduce potential impacts from disturbance on the nesting eagle, and create the largest area possible of restored habitat, particularly for sensitive fish species in the remaining area. Like alternative 4A, alternative 4B would reduce the transportation, air quality, greenhouse gas emission impacts compared to the proposed action, but would not avoid significant impacts. American River Mitigation Sites 4A and 4B were considered under CEQA only in this analysis. Alternatives 4A and 4B were rejected from further consideration under NEPA, as it was determined that these alternatives would result in the site not meeting concurrent mitigation requirements for specific habitat types, would increase the number of additional mitigation sites needed, result in additional land acquisitions, and result in overall substantial increased costs to fulfill the mitigation requirements. Both alternatives 4A and 4B would retain a substantial portion of the ARMS pond, approximately 20 or 30 acres. However, under these alternatives, the habitat mitigation requirements to address the impacts of the overall project could not be accommodated on the ARMS site. If alternatives 4A or 4B were implemented, additional habitat mitigation would need to be constructed elsewhere on the lower American River, where opportunities are extremely limited, or mitigation credits purchased, which may not be readily available.
The last project component discussed in this SEIS-SEIR is the piezometer network. A piezometer is a tool that measures underground water pressure, and we use it to monitor groundwater levels and flow patterns. So this network will be installed after the construction of each project's component, and it will be located within the 2016 authorized project footprint, as you can see outlined in this figure. The purpose is to collect data to evaluate the long-term performance of the levee improvements and the flood risk reduction measures. The image of this piezometer is shown on your right to give you an idea of the scale. This actually was taken on a Sacramento River East Levee, or SREL, and was installed by USACE. Now, we will be, they'll be a little bit different because they will have a solar panel so that the data can be collected and sent remotely to the district. So there will be minor environmental impacts associated with the installation of these. It does require a drill rig to install down to drill down to the groundwater level. So there will be noise and visual and some recreational impacts associated with the installation, and that would be a temporary and minor disruption to maybe people on the bike trail. There would not be full closures, but it may be loud in that area for a day or two. Mitigation measures would be implemented to ensure that there is no groundwater contamination. So now that we have wrapped up all of the different project components, I did want to discuss cultural resources briefly. Our cultural resources specialist put together this slide, but could not make it to this presentation today. However, I did want to discuss that USACE has identified potential impacts related to cultural, historic, archaeological, and tribal resources resulting from the project. This process involves completion of a programmatic agreement with the California Historic Preservation or State Historic Preservation Officer, excuse me, or the SHPO. Each phase of ARCF has a uniquely developed process to protect these resources. Resources have been identified through research, site surveys, ground testing, and consultation with the public and Native American tribes. Additionally, we welcome any information from the public regarding via local knowledge or identification of cultural resources. So I wanted to discuss the milestone schedule for this document. Going back, we started this process in about October of 2022. We opened up for scoping, for public scoping in November of 2022. I wanted to note that comments received during the scoping period are included in an appendix in this SEIS, SEIR, and have responses from both USACE and the project partners. So those are available to review anytime. We released this draft, SEIS, SEIR, in just last month, December. The public comment period is open now and ends February 5th. I have outlined just the basic milestones as we expect them to come for finalizing this document. We expect that the Federal Register notification will go out in either August or September of this year, with the record of decision being signed and CEQA certification occurring in the fall. Briefly, and will be followed by the Delta Stewardship Council consistency determination. Next slide. So we have outlined the general construction schedule as we anticipate it now. Of course, this is subject to change based on comments received, our contracting process, how the weather goes, all that kind of stuff. But this is as best as we can predict at the time. Oh, I won't go through too many details, but MCP is the Magpie Creek project, scheduled to just be a single season construction window in 2027. American River Erosion Contract 3B is scheduled to start summer of 2024 and complete in the winter of 2026. American River Erosion Contract 4A is a two season window in the summer of 2026 and the winter of 2027. American River Erosion Contract 4B is in the very early designs, and we are not sure when that will happen quite yet. Sacramento River Erosion Contract 3 will begin summer 2025, and it will be just a single season in that year. The mitigation site for the American River will begin in the summer 2025, likely through the end of 2027. SRMS, or Sacramento River Mitigation Site, is expected to start summer 2025 as well, and only last two seasons until the winter of 2026. Our piezometer network installation will occur as each project component is completed, and so we expect that to go through all the way until the end of 2029. I did want to note that generally our construction, you know, we begin mobilizing in the spring of the year, but we have to wait until the rain stops to really get going. So generally the construction starts in the summer and it wraps up by the time that the winter rains come. So that is all for the SEIS, SEIR. Here is that SACLIVI upgrades website. And likely you already found it because you're here and you found, you know, the WebEx links and everything. I wanted to point out these red arrows that you can subscribe for construction updates. You can get on our email list. So once construction begins, you'll have all that information available to you. There's also a work inquiry and a concern submission form. So this is someplace you can go. You can submit something here and we will look into it. And finally, I have provided the email addresses so that you can submit formal comments. I've also provided our mailing addresses for both the Army Corps of Engineers and the Department of Water Resources. We have received comments already, so we are getting them. We appreciate all of them, and we do value your input. We are providing now, at the end of this presentation, a 2-minute time slot for each participant so that you can have any clarifications needed. But we do request that you provide written comments so that they can be fully considered in the final SEIS-SEIR. Thank you so much for attending.
Okay, I'm going to start my video so that you can actually see someone's face today. So as I kind of ended the pre-recorded part of the presentation, I know we listed this presentation only go till 6:30 today. You know, this is just how life works. We're going to hopefully get everyone's comment today. If we have to stop, I think you know, we have 156 participants. I think we can get through 2 minutes for everyone. That's why we're doing it this way. We want to hear from everyone. We're going to start like a timer for each person. What's Bailey putting in the chat? Yeah, so I think I can see that everyone has when their hand raised. So I think I'll just start at the top, which I think it's alphabetical. And let me see if I can just go one by one and unmute you. So the first hand I see is Naomi E. So I will go ahead and unmute you. And then it looks like you have to.
Yes, hi, this is Naomi.
Okay, great. So I have a time at now 6:24. So when I see that time at 6:26, I will have to kind of stop you so that we can make sure everyone's comments are covered. We're going to be listening and we're going to be recording this part so we can transcribe it later and properly respond. I won't be able to address everyone's comments today. We have a huge team here working on this document. I am not the lead on American River erosion contracts or Magpie Creek projects, or the piezometer network. I'm not an engineer, I'm an environmental manager. So what we're doing today is just gonna, we're gonna transcribe your comments so that we can adequately respond when we are preparing the final EIS-EIR. So why don't you start, Naomi?
Yes, hi, thanks for the chance to be here. My biggest request right now is an extension so that everybody that would like to share their comments has the opportunity to do that. An extension on the deadline for public comment. As stated that we just got this information, and I live close to the current Sac State project, and I was, you know, we had a team that got the signs up there was no signs around here when the trees were cut down. We had to really advocate to get some signage put up, and then when the signs were put up, it didn't indicate any of this current work that's going to be happening between Watt and Howe. That would have given people a lot more opportunity to respond. And I'm also like the vibrational impact of what's happening. I live there and I felt my entire apartment building shaking. They had to put up sensors to make sure that structural damage didn't happen to the building. But unfortunately, they put those sensors up pretty much after most of the ground shaking work was done. Also, I've seen bank erosion where the trees were removed. I never saw that before. Before the trees and grass were removed, the banks were stable. But in the project work area, it's pretty concerning because we haven't had that much rain compared to last year. I can't imagine what it would look like right now if I'm just concerned about this work actually being as effective as it's the cost of removing all of the amazing trees that are holding the ground, that are providing habitat for birds, for, you know, the right habitat for the fish and the salmon. And also another question is on the other side of the river, there's also a little bit more accessible too, and why isn't that being considered? You know, and these are all questions that everybody has. Also, the project work that was done downstream, there's still no grass growing after 2 years. So that's pretty concerning for me. That was not the current project. That was the previous project, and there's still no grass there. So okay. There's a lot of concerns.
Thanks, Naomi. That was about 3 minutes, I think. I can kind of summarize your concerns, and I see that you've been putting them in the chat too. I hear that that you are interested in having an extension. I hear that you're having concerns about tree removals, vibrational impacts. I am seeing other people put that in the chat as well. Thank you for those comments. I really do appreciate it. I am going to go to the next person. And I do want to say, you know, we are transcribing these, but it is very, it's difficult to capture all of that, right? So if you can put those in the chat, or you can email those email addresses, where we do a much better job at responding, okay?
Okay, thank you.
So I'm going to go to Bill. And Naomi, if you can put your hand down, you can hit that little hand button and say, lower your hand. And that way, I can go to the next person. So Bill Breton, I'm going to unmute you. And it's 6:28, so I'll give you about 2 minutes, okay?
Yeah, hi. This is Bill Breton. I'm a California registered civil engineer, recently retired from the Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board, where I worked for 25 years. Doing both surface water and groundwater regulation, including stormwater and erosion work and so forth, overseeing that regulatorily. So I've already submitted some comments, written comments, but I just now realized that some of my comments weren't quite the way I had intended, because up along the north side of the Larchmont Park are about a dozen heritage oak trees up to 350 years old that we're very concerned about and trying to save. And I'm concerned that those are being removed unnecessarily to install a launchable rock at the base of the levee. And that is because the erosion that's occurring down at the riverbank, which is about 150 to 200 feet width of bank down at the bottom where the river is very minor, has been moving very slowly, and has been monitored by the American River Flood Control District and Sacramento Area Flood Control Agency for years. And most recently, in their 2017 monitoring report, they found that the erosion at this site does not threaten the levee due to the width of the berm. And I would agree with that. However, if the trees are removed, I think that erosion is going to move much more quickly. And the launchable rock, if it ever gets to where you're placing the launchable rock, it's going to be too late anyway. So you're basically removing all those trees for no reason. And it's not going to prevent the levee from being undermined, and we're going to lose all those beautiful trees. So I was just wondering if the Corps has even looked at those monitoring reports, and why they're still proposing to do the launchable rock at the base of the levee despite the width of the berm and the findings of the monitoring reports.
Okay, I hear you. I hear concerns about these heritage oak trees near Larchmont Park. I think that there's a lot of people that are concerned about removal of these trees and the necessity. So thank you for telling us that in person. I think you have put in the chat as well. If you could talk about the monitoring reports in the chat, which ones you're talking about, that way we can talk to our engineers and say, yes, we have looked at those. We've done all of our hydraulic modeling that shows this, and we will get back to you with that formal response. Okay,
I'll put the details of the report title.
Yeah, any details that anybody can provide. You're an engineer, former engineer, retired engineer. I'm not an engineer. It's not my area of expertise. So we would love, any details you can put in the chat.
I'll
thanks so much,
that.
Bill.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks. Yeah, if you could put your hand down. I think that someone said that I skipped someone named Connolly. So if your last name is Connolly and you wanted to go ahead, I'm just going in order of my chat. It might be a little different, but if not, I will touch back with this person name. Let's go to, I have an L Merritt, MD. I'm going to go ahead and unmute you.
Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, we can.
Hi, yeah, this is Dr. Lisa Merritt. Thank you for this very comprehensive presentation and all the hard work being done to strengthen our levee system by reducing erosion, seepage, and protection from overtopping and getting through the Zoom glitches that we've all lived through the last 3 years. This is a huge project, a very important project, and to me, similar to the precise planning of a complex surgery, the pre-op planning lab and image testing that we need to do if we're going to do it right. And we appreciate finally having this information session regarding the possible fate of our well-established and well-connected community and surrounding ecosystem that I have enjoyed for probably longer than most of you who are talking to us are. I've been on the earth probably about 35 years. I would like to know where in the SCIR we can find the responses to the issues raised in the prior peer review report. There were a number of them. In addition to the concern about noise, increased compromise of air quality with dust, toxic emissions, and worsening heat island effects, there is also a protective effect of the River Parkway from the heavily forested habitat. When you look at the environmental justice screening tools, there appears to be a protective effect of the River Parkway along the Route 50 corridor and Watt Avenue, where the particulates are at the 95th to 100th percentile, but reduced to the 8th percentile or lower, closer to the river. So what's the predicted impact of this C3P project on heat, air quality, fine particulates, increased cancer risk, and the risk of aggravation of respiratory disorders? I'm also very concerned about the mental health impacts because this is a major recreational area that people come from other areas. As you well know, we have over 4 million visits a year, and people come here to escape the heat, people who are economically disadvantaged, very much enjoy and recreate and exercise of all ages. How will the presence of heavy equipment, the dust, the noise of vibrations, not only affect the animals and the wildlife, but as well the humans, those of us living there, as well as those who usually will enjoy this and no longer have access to this beautiful environment? Did I go into that? Did okay with my time?
That was beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Yes, and we received, I remember your name coming through for your emails, so we already did receive emails from you, and I'm sure we've received emails from a lot of you already, so thank you for that. We have disclosed all the impacts for wildlife, like you said, but also for humans. We have environmental justice section just dedicated to that, so I think you'll find a lot of these if you start reading the document, the SEIS SEIR. You can start with the executive summary. That might help you. It's a big table and it shows all of the resources that we analyzed, and it shows you the impacts and the mitigation. You can kind of start there. If you have, you know, further questions on accessing the document, things like that, you're not finding what you need, you can definitely send us an email and we can try to get you like a page number, specifics like that, okay? All right, thanks for your comment. I will be going to, let's see, Eliza Morris. Can send you your mute on request.
Hi, thank you. So I second a lot of the things everyone else has been saying. I live on that 3B South portion of the river and cannot even imagine what it's gonna be like for all of us, but I have a very specific question. So I commute along the levee that goes over from where we live by Waterton up along the levee on bicycle and then into Sac State where I work. And so I know I read through your whole thing and a lot of actually those mitigation things you were talking about say that the impact's terrible, acknowledged terrible. I think it's significant and unavoidable is what the terminology was. But there was nothing about alternate bike routes for people who use that levee. It said something about maybe if there was recreational people, you might look into something. But for those of us who commute with it, we obviously need something in the same space. So what is the plan for that? And then it's not just me. I'm one person who bikes, but lots of our neighborhood does. And so if you incorporate the calculation, I actually don't have a second car, so I don't even have another option, but other people will drive instead of biking. And so have you incorporated that into your greenhouse gas calculations?
Okay, thank you, Eliza, for that comment. Yes, recreational impacts, we have had to spend a lot of time assessing recreational impacts.
Not recreational, though, because it's commuting to get to work. So.
I'm taking notes as we go, just so I can keep my own record. So commuting and also greenhouse gas impacts associated with having to take a car. For example, you can't take a second car, but if you have to take a bus now or you have to do things like that. So you're asking about greenhouse gas impacts related to that. Okay, I got that. Let's see. Thank you for keeping to that time slot. I am going to go ahead and ask the next person on my list, which is Gerald. I don't know how to pronounce your last name. D-J-U-T-H. I'm going to unmute you.
Hi, can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Thank you. Yeah, my last name's Juice.
Okay.
I've been a resident near this Contract 3B area for over 30 years. I've walked that stretch of the American River thousands of times. I'm also a retired professional geologist. I'm a certified engineering geologist and a professional civil engineer. And I've had some experience with stream bank erosion and slope stability projects during my career. I'm opposed to this remedy for the south bank of the American River between Watt and Mayhew Drain. I believe that engineering solutions, you know, are most effective when you put the correct solution applied for the situation. And what they're proposing on this stretch, the launchable toe and launchable trench, that may have been necessary for the areas downstream by Paradise Beach that showed such distress during the previous floods. But I don't think that our Army Corps recognizes that that the South Bank here is different. This stretch of the river has, in most places, intense vegetation, mature riparian vegetation that provides natural armoring to slow the water velocities, stabilize the soils, and cushion the slopes from water flow. And unlike the downstream areas, it's held up really well to the flood events that we've had in the past. I believe that this strategy is poorly thought out. It seems like Army Corps is trying to do a one-size-fits-all to all reaches of the river. And I think that destroying the riparian vegetation here will actually exacerbate the erosion potential. It'll lead to higher water velocities against the levee and the banks and cause more erosion. And that's going to lead to a situation where they're going to have to come in later and put in more riprap. Once they go down that slope, it's going to continue. So I implore Army Corps to reconsider their proposal. I'd like to know if they've actually considered any other alternatives besides this launchable toe and launchable trench for this area. I think that there's many technical things that they could do to increase the protection of the levees that don't include removing all those trees and destroying the root structure of all that vegetation. They could use armoring to protect the toe, but it needs to be in place in such a way that it enhances and protects the natural vegetation, not destroy it.
Okay.
I'm going to stop you there. I hear that you're looking for alternatives. Has the Corps considered all of these alternatives? It's not a one-size-fit-all type plan for all stretches of the river. Thank you. I really urge you to submit a written comment so I can send that to the right people and get the response that you deserve, okay? I'm going to unmute Greg Fishman.
Thank you. My name is Greg Fishman. I'm a member of the SMUD Board of Directors. I'm also a member of the board of the American River Parkway Foundation. These comments are my own. I'm not speaking for either of those boards, but I did want to make this affiliation known. You're checking some great boxes here. You're holding a couple of great public forums, but I can tell you, I don't think you're imparting a whole lot of information that's valuable to most of us. I'm glad that you've got some professional engineers on this call that are offering some alternatives. I agree with the last gentleman who spoke that this seems to be a project that is a one size fits all. And I know from a prior work experience that the Army Corps was planning to do a flood control project in downtown Napa that involved a lot of riprap. And the entire Napa community came together and said, no, we want something better. And what they have now is actually a model for what can be done instead of riprap. It is a usable channel that is available for recreation most of the year and still serves as a flood control channel for those high water events. This is a completely different project, and I'm speaking specifically about the American River project here. It's a completely different project, I get that, but what I'm asking you to do is to think outside the box. I agree completely with the last gentleman, the riparian habitat that you're going to be destroying is irreplaceable. And I guess the last thing I would say is your mitigation in downstream at Discovery Park, I'm sure that's going to be great for the salmon and the birds, and that's important, absolutely, but it does not do anything for the environment here in our neighborhoods that is also being destroyed. And I will put this in official in written comments and submit it. But I would just urge you to rethink this and try to think outside the box instead of just doing a one size fits all project.
Okay, thank you for that comment. I realize that there's a lot of things that we're trying to balance, you know. We're not trying to just cut all the trees down, we're not just trying to rock the entire levee, but we do have to balance public safety with, you know, the wildlife and with everything that's out there. Thank you for submitting a written comment shortly. And I do think that hearing some of these comments today and maybe wanting to speak with some, you know, engineering folks, it sounds like maybe we can put together another meeting. Specifically, it sounds like maybe for 3B, American River Erosion Contract 3B. So that's on our awareness now. And let me unmute the next person. I have David B.
Am I unmuted?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, hi, my name's David Ball. My family's lived in the College Green's East neighborhood for close to 30 years. We regularly use the Larchmont Park. My family walks the levee, the trails, up and down the river daily for exercise. We kayak on the river in the summer months. The park and the river are a large part of why we enjoy living here. And I just don't see a reason to intervene and disrupt the river and all its surroundings to stop or limit erosion. From what we've seen, there's been little to none in the 30 years that we've lived here. Even if there was, the plan drawn up appears to destroy much of the natural ecosystem of the river, as well as the natural beauty that all my neighbors enjoy about living here, as well as the habitat for the many wildlife that we see in that area. I could see a project that went in, made improvements, moved rocks that were native to the environment into strategic areas, and then left the river in a state that looked much like man had never touched it. But I don't think that's what this is. this project appears to be something different, attempting to alter the river's natural process that survived for probably billions of years by intervening now. I know we probably won't be able to stop the project from moving forward, because I know there's probably lots of money and lots of jobs on the line, but I'm going to continue to ask that you do it with a light hand and try to make it look like as though it was never touched, because it can be done. That's all I have.
Okay. Thank you for your comment, David.
Yeah. Thanks for the time.
Okay. I see that we have a lot of hands raised, so I'm going to try to just keep going, okay? I want to get through everyone tonight. Daniel Irola, going to unmute you.
Hi there. Thank you. I have about 10 pages of comments already, so I'm not going to get into great detail. I am a professional wildlife biologist. I have 40 years experience in environmental consulting, and I just want to make a couple of points. First of all, really an extension is needed here. I don't want to cast aspersions toward any of the staff or the consultants, but the decision to release this document when you did creates the appearance that you really don't want public input. And if you actually do want public input, I think you need to demonstrate that by giving a project of this complexity more time for people to understand, absorb, and to comment. Secondly, I will just say that there's still, on my part, despite considerable effort, a lot of lack of clarity about what the project is actually going to consist of. And I'm talking about Area 3A and B. You know, what's a construction buffer? A construction buffer would seem to be an area adjacent to a construction site, but there are no construction sites identified on the documents. Or you know, it's not possible to make comments on a project that is not presented in an understandable fashion. So the comments about having an additional meeting where we can actually understand what's going on in order to comment, I think, is critical. And then lastly, I'll just say very quickly for general knowledge, the biological resources analysis is really quite disappointing. The mitigation measures that are applied are very minimal and don't address some fundamental comments that I will be making, especially regarding the impacts of the Arusha Pond destruction on wintering water birds that use that area, importantly, as a roost site, and some other issues that I won't go into at this point. So thank you.
Okay, thank you for all that. I appreciate it. I know you commented during our scoping too. So yes, I'm glad you're back. All right, I am going to go to a person named Pell, P-E-L-L-E.
Hello. Hi, I'm with the City of Sacramento.
Okay.
It's a long document. I think I'm getting it. Page 3-7 talks about all alternatives being analyzed at an equal level of detail. I'm interested in haul routes. It looks like only haul routes were provided for alternative to the proposed project. And so, like, there's no haul routes for all 1, 3, or 4. So I just wanted to verify that. My other comment was on page 3-12. It talks about only what has changed from the 2016 document is discussed. Okay, it says for this SEIS-SEIR, the proposed action only includes project components that are modifications or design refinements of the 2016 document. So with regard to the haul routes, are all the haul routes included in this supplemental? Or if I want to see the complete list of haul routes, do I need to look at the 2016 document and this document? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I'm not sure.
we'll have to check back on that, whether we have figures for all the haul routes. Yeah, obviously, this is just a supplemental document. It's a huge supplemental document.
Yes.
But there's a lot of information in the 2016. And there are links on the website to that if needed. I'm sure we'll see your comment in writing here soon so that we can.
Okay. It's almost, I didn't look at the 2016 document, but we have situations when neighbors get involved and we're not aware of things. So I think my comment would just, you know, we're interested in public noticing. And it's kind of difficult I understand the layout of the document. You can't include everything from before, but really we need to consider the 2016 and the supplemental in terms of working with neighbors and what they can expect as far as traffic impacts, because I get the sense there may be additional material in the 2016, but I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, for things like that where you're not sure, you're not ready to submit a formal comment, if you want to comment, we've been responding when people need assistance in submitting their formal comment. So if you need help or you can't find the right thing, go ahead and email us and we'll get you that information, okay?
Okay, either of the two emails?
Yeah, or you can put it here in the chat today.
Okay, thanks.
And then if people can push that raise hand button when you're all set, and then I can go to the next person. I have someone named Pete. Gonna unmute you. Pete, let's see. Are you there, Pete?
Yep.
Okay,
I'll repeat. I'll get right to my point. The erosion control contract 3B will not add one additional ounce of flood protection to Sacramento. Instead, it will kill between 500 and 700 trees, including many heritage oaks. It will destroy acres of vegetation. Vegetation that holds the bank together and slows water flow, both of which provide protection from erosion. The contract will remove public access to many of the most popular fishing sites, wildlife viewing areas, and watercraft access points. And I'll repeat, it will not add one additional ounce of flood protection. The American River is designated as a wild and scenic river under both the state and federal laws. You're destroying many of the outstanding recreational features that earn that designation. In fact, it will totally destroy the clay banks and Pirates Cove, areas that were part of the original Sarah Park, the inspiration for the entire American River Parkway. You're stealing these features of our crown jewel, not only from us, but from future generations as well. In the days ahead, you're going to be receiving many detailed comments documenting shortcomings in the SEIR. You'll see that river flow velocities next to the bank in the stretch of a river are extremely low, in many places less than a mile an hour. I hope and pray that you'll take the time to read the comments and stop this contract. So go back to your calculators, go back to your models. Come up with a targeted, data-driven erosion control plan that we can live with. One that strengthens specific areas without obliterating trees, spawning areas, cormorant roosts, and beaches. This is more than saving up to 700 trees from slaughter. This is about preserving the crown jewel of Sacramento for generations to come, and providing protection without devastation. The Corps, SAFCA, and Central Valley Flood Protection Board have done great work to protect Sacramento. You strengthen levees slurry walls, you increase the Folsom Dam spillway capacity. These were great projects, but Erosion Control Project 3B, it's not one of them. It's a bad idea, a very bad idea, and it will not add any additional flood protection. My name is Pete Spaulding. I'm the volunteer mile steward for Mile 11 south of the American River Parkway. I live on Rio Bravo Circle, and like a lot of my neighbors that have commented, I've been here for 30 years as well. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Pete. Let's move on to Jay Gabelli. I'm going to unmute you.
It's actually Gable. Thank you very much. That's my last name. I am actually Very concerned, and I also agree that I do believe you need to extend the time period by which you're allowing the public and also peer agencies to review what's been compiled. You have a massive amount of documents, and the site, you know, has been difficult. You need to look at both the original EIR EIS plus the supplementals and subsequent versions. And in looking at this, and just as the gentleman before me, Pete, was talking about contract 3B, I would definitely have very deep concerns. We've been looking at what was some of the data that supposedly is linked to the site selections. And you can see, for example, in certain points where maybe only two samples were taken out of 25 that were recommended, and even those don't appear to line up. And then I also have looked at some of the velocity discussions that you've offered in both the original and then the subsequent information, and see materials where you can see sourcing of old data brought into the rebranding of a new study. That is concerning. The data may or may not be valid, but it's part of the integrity that the public, I think, is trying to communicate to you, is that, you know, the site selection seems to be a one size fits all. And if we look at some of the original scope, it was talking about 22 miles of what really from Nimbus Dam down on the Lower American River is the entire American River Parkway. That parkway is the lifeblood of Sacramento and the greater Sacramento region of which we live around. It's an economic engine for us in this community. It's been measured all the way back to 2008 to, I believe the number is $364 million a year that comes around it. Just an example, you've studied and looked at the salmon fisheries. I think some of that data still even needs to be updated to a more current biological opinion, because the studies that we've looked at have shown the reds and 90 or 95% of them are Watt Avenue and above. So you are dealing with an extremely sensitive area, especially in the 3B area. And to do mitigation to one point down at Discovery Park when, you know, just using that species, you know, salmon or steelhead species as an example, the entire parkway can't shift there. And you're going too fast. You know, you're going to cut down, you know, flora and fauna and trees, the ecosystems that the wildlife and the species rely on that also are important to, you know, heat and pollution. It's a water quality. We're all part of that ecosystem. So I just feel like, you know, it isn't one size fits all. We really do, as a group with you and others that are participating in the study, really need to make sure that we're right. And we need to be much, much more surgical in our mitigation. And there needs to be preservation first in mind, then on-site mitigation priorities. And we also need to look at the pace and take in the impacts, not just myopically of each section, but the work that's already been done, where, for example, in the Paradise Beach area, all that riparian habitat's gone. That's impacting the river now. And the more that you take...
I'm sorry, you've been about double your time. You've made a lot of good points, and I really hope to see a written comment from you so that we can respond to all of that, okay?
Yes, and please do an in-person meeting, because okay. We are having huge difficulties with the graphics, and even when we enlarge them, they get pixelated, because the original source graphics in a lot of your documents are like that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much. Joshua Thomas, I'm going to unmute you. Joshua Thomas? I can hear you now.
Want to play?
Hello?
Yep, we can hear you again.
Okay. Well, so considering how massively destructive these rock trenches and tows are, the Corps does not appear to attempt to justify them, especially for Contract 3B, and especially around the clay banks in Project 3B South and in front of Larchmont Community Park. really the only documents that the SEIS SEIR reference for justification, the geotechnical report and the erosion protection analysis from the 2016 general reevaluation report. And the geotechnical report found that in this area, no seepage and stability deficiencies exist, and it recommended no further improvements in the area containing Project 3B. It says this on page 16. Then the erosion protection analysis and recommended they take the Corps do more boring, take more boring samples and do more studies because of a high degree of variability in bed materials. But the Corps does not appear to have collected more samples or done more studies. And in fact, the closest boring it took was at Howie, which is nowhere near the area between the Mayhew Drain and Watt Avenue, where they're cutting down 522 trees. So why didn't the Corps follow through the recommendations of its panel of experts to take more boring samples? And how can it justify a massive project that will bulldoze 500 trees and for 2 years pump diesel exhaust and particulate matter into the air near an elementary school? Thank you.
Thank you for your comment, Joshua. I will move to Peter Connolly.
Yeah, hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, good evening. So I just want to emphasize everyone on this call that definitely submit a written comment letter. Everybody has some really relevant comments. So please try to get your comments on record. So looking at the project description from a kind of a higher elevation, it seems like the analysis just relies on some very overgeneralized claims that this erosion protection is needed and is based on very minimal, like I said, overgeneralized data. I think there's minimal justification for the project specifically. There is not one instance of levee seepage specifically on the south side of the American River upstream of Watt Avenue. I've lived in this area probably over 40 years. And there's been some extensive rain events that the levee has held up and performed as designed. And I just think this is an a misuse of federal and state funds that could be appropriated in some other area, environmental work, maybe some more targeted erosion controls somewhere downstream at like Sac State, the work that was done at Sac State, I think that's justified. And then also my neighborhood's not even in a flood zone, so I don't understand why there's a statement, basically you even made the statement that we have to consider safety over the environment. And there's really very minimal risk, in my opinion, that this area is going to be inundated by a significant flood event specifically from failure of the levee. I think in 1992, they pumped a bunch of slurry along the levee that goes down, I don't know how deep it goes, maybe 100 feet. So I don't think this levee is going anywhere. So I'm just going to put all my comments in a comment letter and make sure it gets on the record. I really appreciate your time and you taking the time to have this meeting.
Okay. Thank you so much, Peter. We look forward to seeing those comments. I am going to go to William Avery.
Hi, thanks for the opportunity to speak. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
So this is Dr. William Avery, also a professional biologist and a professor emeritus at Sac State. Contract 3B proposes clearing riverbanks of vegetation and trees, including heritage oaks and other valuable tree species of heritage size, black walnuts, cottonwoods, Oregon ash, and white alder. On the south side of the river from Watt to Larchmont. Excuse me. This is an area with well-established self-renewing vegetative armoring provided by the existing root network and relatively impervious to erosion of flow velocities less than 8 feet per second, expected at 150,000 CFS for a 200-year flood event. More advanced models that take into account vegetation and trees suggest that the actual bankside flows at 160,000 CFS, maybe even less than that. These models need to be considered by the Army Corps in their analysis. Table 4-4 in the general GRR erosion appendix suggests that vegetation such as Class A turf grass can withstand flows up to 8 feet per second. Root et al. 2014 found that mature riparian trees are even superior to grass, and that we recommend that riparian forests should be conserved to provide banks of stability and to maintain an equilibrium of river and floodplain dynamics. Further, C3B proposes to dig trenches filled with rocks, lay in revetment on the cleared banks, and cover this treatment with soil to create planting benches for the 2 years of the construction and 2 to 5 years post-construction. It takes for significant vegetation growth and any form of vegetation armoring to occur. These soils will be vulnerable to erosion at velocities as low as 2 to 4 feet per second, also from the table 4-4. So soil erosion's risk actually goes up during this 4 to 7 year time period. Am I about ready to get cut off?
I'm pretty close.
Okay, let me go.
You can summarize for me.
I can go to the last, my little summary statement, and tell you that I posted this in the comments. It'll also go in with the regular, you know, comment portal. For these reasons, we ask that the South Bank erosion protection projects upstream of the Watt Avenue Bridge, especially in the Fair Oaks Formation clay banks, protected zones of Sarah Park, River Miles 9 to 11, be removed from Contract 3B. If critical spots are identified where erosion repair is required, we ask that a surgical approach be applied, working in from the river's edge using habitat-preserving biotechnical engineering. Thanks for listening.
Thank you, William.
Sure.
Nancy Niskern, gonna unmute you.
Sir, if you're talking, we can't hear you. You need to unmute.
Is this working?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Okay, thank you. I live close to the Mayhew behind my house. My bedroom window is about 20 feet from the levee, and I'm afraid that they're going to use that to do your construction of moving great equipment along this area, which is going to raise dust, particulate matter, and also big vibration on the house. And I wonder if there's any mitigation or help on anything that might be hurt during that time or unusually uncomfortable. I am concerned that you're taking out a lot of the old oaks and other riparian trees that are decades old and cannot be easily replaced. The forest has developed complexity with different ranges of trees, providing habitat for many species of birds and other wildlife. One thing we have to embrace is that these older trees, these old heritage oaks, are cavities, required resting, nesting habitat and shelter for species, including wood ducks, common mergansers, barn owls, ash-throated flycatchers, and about 4 other species. It takes time for this habitat to develop, and removing it and the wildlife will be gone as well. If you remove the trees, you'll remove the wildlife. It's a heartbreak to me at this older age to see that the river's going to be shut down to my access for 2 years and then not be able to be repairing itself for another 6 years. And I doubt if I'll ever have the use of that river again. It makes me very sad. I'm also a little worried about the cavalier attitude of the Corps, because you very nice, very agreeable, but you should be having a recorder for your meeting and maybe an engineer present. I wish you would answer the questions when you promise to answer them, as in the chat questions that were posed on 12/12 with the meeting of the Corps and the Lower American River Task Force. I have asked public affairs about that. Nobody's gotten back to me. I don't always get an answer in public affairs or a return. And customer service very carefully. And I've always been told if you go up against the Corps, don't bother because they will go ahead with their projects no matter what you have to say. And that's a bit of a heartbreak. And I do think you have people that listen. And I have worked with the Corps before, and it's been a very, very good process. And what you do in the Missouri River, I've been reading about, because they also had bank stabilization projects. And you've done a lot of good work.
Okay, thanks for your comment, Nancy. I'm sorry that we haven't been responsive.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Nancy. I'm going to ask Michelle Stevens.
Go. Sorry, I couldn't unmute myself. I needed help.
No problem.
In the sky. But I have worked at Bushy Lake for over 5 years collecting data on Western pond turtle conservation. We have years of data on birds using the area. And I'm an ethnoecologist, so I've been planting culturally important plant species, and I'm an emeritus professor. Anyway, one thing that is really important is the Northwestern pond turtles, which is the turtles we have here, have been proposed as listed as threatened by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. I will provide you a great deal of information from our data and from our letters supporting listing. I think all of us who observe wildlife along the river will attest to the fact that we have a rather small population of Northwestern pond turtles, especially relative to non-native turtles. So what I would suggest is, A, when you were doing construction on the levee area near Sac State, those turtles were brumating. That means they're asleep. So I don't know if they could get away from the construction at all. So there should be windows of construction when they're avoiding brumation, when they're nesting, they'll be going back and forth between the terrestrial and the aquatic habitat. I would recommend you do basking habitat along the river and at the restoration site. The other thing, please consider the Lower American River as an integrated, intact, highly truncated and fragmented habitat corridor. So it's one ecosystem, and the animals have already, deer, coyotes, bobcats, they're already really in a very small area. So if you could stage the construction to maintain a corridor for wildlife, that'd be great. Also, green and white sturgeon are both listed. They should be included as fish in your wildlife section. Also, I'm working with tribes planting, gathering, and tending at Bushy Lake. I strongly advise you to use Carex barbarae. It's God's gift to bank stabilization and restoration. And other important plants, mugwort, Indian hemp, milkweed, I'll provide all that. But I strongly urge you to use culturally significant plants in your plant mix. And the last thing, because I know I only have 2 minutes, is, you know, I really, really recommend you do a walk and talk by the river. We have a lot of knowledge. If we could see the sites with you, it would do a great benefit for public relations, and we could all benefit from each other's observations and knowledge. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Michelle. I see, let's see, next is Jessica Wiseman.
Hi, thank you. I'm not going to repeat many of my concerns that are shared by my neighbors and larger community. I wanted to offer another request. I'm going to read exactly what I wrote in the comments, not knowing what's going to be considered based upon whether it's posted or whether it's vocally stated. Larchmont Park, Man Love Water Station, the area between Watt and Waterton, as well as the areas off American River Drive, are all deemed staging areas. These areas back up to houses. I'd like to know what analysis has been done for ground pollution, structural pool damage, impact on children and residents with compromised health issues. In addition to air and noise pollution, can you please address these issues specifically for those of us with literally these staging areas feet from our backyards? Thank you. And I just want to reiterate that this is a supplementary comment. There's been several people that have stated very important issues regarding the environmental impacts, the necessity of a blanket of approach versus targeted erosion control, that I'm in full support of further investigation as well. Thank you so much for offering us the opportunity for this public forum. And again, I urge you to offer yet another public forum, particularly in person, for further analysis and complete transparency for our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. I'm going to go to Mikkel Jensen. I'm probably not pronouncing that right. M-I-K-K-E-L.
Yes. Hi, thank you. I'm Mikkel Jensen. I'm a professor at Sac State, and I live just south of the river, Watt Avenue. I don't want to reiterate too much of what people have said. I agree with what everybody has said about the impact. It pains me to think of what will happen to the vegetation and the wildlife and the natural treasure that is the river, which is, you know, really, I think, as a resident, a privilege to get to enjoy, as well as the impact on day-to-day life. I feel the impact of pollution and all the other aspects that have been raised locally need to be considered. The thing that strikes me and that I wanted to comment on is we've heard from many mention that vegetation is really a form of erosion control. And so it shocks me to see the Army Corps of Engineers consider it a liability in the flow of the river. That combined with the previous reports, which seem to indicate that there is not further action needed, really makes me question the justification for the project. And you look at the work that's done across from Sac State, not only is it currently unusable as a recreational space and completely devoid of natural life, it's bare and vulnerable. And it's not a, if you think about erosion, that's not what an erosion resistant bank looks like. And so I wonder if you mentioned the river also needs to accommodate additional flow, if that's where the issue comes in. Is the goal actually to control erosion, or is it to increase the water transport capacity of the river? Because those are two very different goals. You know, some of the plans that I'm hearing is we have to remove the vegetation in order to up the flow capacity of the river. But now you're not describing a river. Now you're describing a canal, which is a very different thing. And so I would like to hear more discussion on what's the goal here. Is it to actually control erosion, or is it to accommodate the water flow, because you're doing it at the expense of having a river?
Okay, thank you for your comment. I see another hand up, Ellen Gantz. Going to unmute you. Let's see, try it again. I can't hear you if you're speaking. We lost your hand. Let me see if I can unmute you. Hi, now I can see you. Hold on, let me try it again. Okay, so I sent you an unmute. I think there's a button you have to click. Okay,
Thank you. So I wonder if there could be someone who can answer questions here at the next meeting, because so many good questions have been asked tonight. I really appreciate so many very knowledgeable people saying good information tonight, and people who have been here so long, that this is a gem of an area. And I moved here 5 years ago because of that. And I have specific questions about what the smog is and what the noise will be, what other people have said about the park. I live three doors down from Larchmont Park, exactly where the staging area will be. I have a son who just turned 8 years old, and now I'm wondering if this will be a safe area to live in when I purchased this home specifically to have this access to this open space. So it's very devastating. And my question really is, what can be done to have this reconsidered and to listen to some of these longtime residents and engineers who are here tonight? Just being in Sacramento for the time I have, and I have been a resident of Sacramento for 15 years, we know the areas that are going to flood, and it's not Area 3B, even though the levee is there. It's just that's not the areas that flood, and it's hard to believe, as others have stated, that removing part of the levee, the vegetation will in any way strengthen it. It's just not common sense. So I would also join in the comments for more meetings, in-person meetings, and hoping that at least after this has all happened, that they do take into account the children and families who live here, and that the recreation is important, the open space is important, and to make sure that that's built into the plans, as well as protecting the nature as best we can. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ellen. E. Sunahara?
Hi, my name is Emily. And I have already put comments in the chat, but I just wanted to mention that I think you're hearing a lot of upset tonight. And I think the way the Army Corps of Engineers has approached this project, especially for the American River Section 3B, it feels very dismissive. Releasing a large technical report over the holiday, public comment period over the holiday, and now we're having a web meeting, not even the courtesy of an in-person meeting. And we're having numerous technical issues on this meeting. And our section of river happens to be the section that has most technical issues. I think it could go a long way to simply help the Corps of Engineers understand that our community wants to be heard. And we are reasonable people. Many of us work in government. Many of us are executives and educators. We know about this area. We know how government works. Please just include us and bring us along, you know, really genuinely try to get our buy-in here, because right now what it feels like is that we're just being appeased with web meetings, and we're being appeased with, public comment period over Christmas and New Year's, and that doesn't feel good, right? And so that will naturally cause upset. If we could have some genuine discussions here, I love the idea of the walk along, the walk and talk. That might go a long way for you guys with this project. Thank you.
Thank you, Emily. Looks like Justin Augustine.
Hi, thanks. This is Justin Augustine. So I'm with the Center for Violence.
Sorry, Justin, I think I muted you.
All right, no problem. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you. Sorry about that.
And should I just start over? I don't know what you guys already heard. I'm sorry.
Yeah, please start over. Yeah.
Okay. So again, I'm Justin Augustine. I work with the Center for Biological Diversity, but I also live near Larchmont Park. And so for obvious reasons, I'm especially concerned about the 3B part of the project. And, you know, I have two kids, 4-year-old daughter, a 7-year-old son, and both of them, they love a number of different spots along the 3B South stretch of the American River. We swim there. There's rope swings they play on. We climb the trees all the time. And I think just most importantly, when we go down there along the edge of the water, it really feels like a magical place, especially the riparian forest along the edge of the river. That's just, it's beautiful. And it's surprising that you're surrounded by an urban landscape, because when you're down there, it feels like you're going back in time to a, you know, a pristine place. And I think we as a community are exceptionally lucky that it exists the way it still exists. And to me, it won't be able to serve that purpose if the plans as they exist go forward. You know, I've seen what happened down near Sac State, and if what happens under 3B is even half as bad as that, it'll just be a complete disaster for the American River as we know it. And so I don't know how anyone can sign off on that as being compatible with the Wild and Scenic River Act. It really isn't. So I hope you really listen to everyone that's already gone before me. There does need to be an alternative solution here that avoids ruining the 3B stretch of the American River. Thanks.
Thank you, Justin. Carrie Necht.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Building on some of the other comments, I just want to share this perspective. You know, we live along the levee, and I too often walk along the river with my children. And, you know, I don't know that we've talked enough here tonight about what this river area really means to the entire city of Sacramento. You know, on summer weekends, it is full. It's really full of people. You know, there's families, there's children, there's all sorts of folks. There are people out there swimming, fishing, getting on and off of rafts, rafting by. It's a very festive area. There are also unhoused people who are finding shade there. And this is all during a time where we've been experiencing record high temperatures, you know, not just midsummer when the public pools are open, but in the months before and after. The county has been identifying public cooling centers, and we ourselves had our air conditioning go out for about a month and, you know, personally use the river as a way to stay cool. And so I would like to know more about the analysis around the public health impacts of this beautiful riverfront area becoming more like a unshaded, I don't know if gravel parking lot is a fair characterization, but that's what kind of the pictures remind me of. You know, we also see bike teams, running groups, and so many people using the area. I think it's a regionally significant project that deserves a 45-day comment period and much wider public outreach. I'm surprised not to have seen, you know, posters up at some of the entrance points to the parkway. I appreciate the postcard which we received, but I think there really should be an effort to really get broad input from everyone in Sacramento, because it's such a heart of the city. And then, you know, in addition to extending the comment period and really meaningfully engaging with alternatives that wouldn't destroy the beauty of the area, you know, also doing a lot more to get public input from the whole city. So thank you for your time here tonight and for letting me comment.
Thank you, Carrie. Let's see, Sarah Densler.
Yeah, hi, thanks. Is it Kelly? Kaylee?
Yeah, it's Kelly.
Okay, Kelly, thank you for staying so long to let us make our comments on this project. I know these processes are really hard on the staff that have to go through all of it too, so I just want to acknowledge that. I live just upstream of the Mayhew Drain, but I have lived here for over 35 years, and I walk this section between here and Watt almost every day, and spend a lot of time out on the parkway. And I also know that one of my neighbors is a retired professor from Sac State, and he's got about 20 years or more of data on nesting birds that includes the area upstream of Mayhew Drain, but also some of downstream of Mayhew Drain. So if you're not aware of that resource for knowing what's going on with the bird population, I recommend contacting him, and I can provide that in my comments. I worked for the Department of Water Resources for most of my career, both running the Urban Streams Restoration Program, which was funding stream projects, and then also working on the Central Valley Conservation Strategy for the Department of Water Resources and the Corps. And I just want to add my voice. I'm not going to repeat a lot of what other people have said, but I want to add my voice with concern about particularly the Section 3B and whether or not the extreme measures that are being proposed are justified, considering the past study results and the incredible impact it will have on the parkway and the length of time it will take for recovery for species. And I also wanted to raise the cumulative impact concerns with the downstream work that's already gone on. A lot of bird and wildlife species were displaced because of that work. And I imagine, I don't have facts, but I imagine that some of those species moved up into our section above Howe and above Watt. And, you know, we're just eliminating more and more of the riparian habitat along the river. And California already has lost over 90 or 95% of its riparian habitat. So every additional incremental loss that we have is just, you know, making it that much harder for species to survive and for, you know, just continuation of wildlife and bird species and also just the potential impacts to the city in terms of water quality and in terms of recreation and all the other things people have mentioned. I won't go on and on. But anyway, thank you very much for taking comments. And I would really like to see an extended comment period and some more in-person meetings to discuss the different aspects of the project. I think it was too many different projects lumped into one overall process on the EIR, and it'd be good to split those up so we can understand and have specific comments for the different areas. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Sarah. Sandra Sanders?
There we go. Kelly, you are a trooper. I just want to say that I work for the Senate Natural Resources and Water Agency, so I have my share of sitting in long hearings and hearing lots of public comment. And so I just want to thank you for, again, like Sarah was saying, allowing us to have this extra time to do that. And I'm not going to be speaking, though, on as a state government employee. I'm going to be speaking as a person that has lived here for 60 years now in this area. And yes, I probably don't look my age, but I have lived in this area a long time. And I align my comments with Bill Avery and with Pete Spaulding and Nancy Nisgern. As I'm not going to repeat, I fully agree with what they're saying about the more targeted approach, less invasive. I was planning on my retirement, you know, being this, enjoying this area. I use it every day. The 3B stretch south that's mentioned is for the construction work. And so I'm really just urging for a targeted approach and only what is necessary, and urge USACE and SAFCA and all the entities involved to take a look at this. And if there's a possible extension, we can work on it and look at it more and do more study and agree that, you know, this, we cannot ever replace, we can ever undo what will be done. And, you know, moving the elderberry trees over to Rio Americano High School and the mitigation efforts that are mentioned still are not going to replace our 200 and 300 year old heritage oak trees that I have seen all my life. And it's not going to do much for me to wait 20 more years when I'm 80 years old for some of the growth to come back and the habitat to be gone. So, yes, there's an emotional aspect for those that actually live here. And I'm just urged that it would be not so invasive and to do only what is necessary and save as much of our habitat as possible. Thank you.
Thanks, Sandra. Mark Berry?
That working yet?
I hear you now.
Okay, thank you. It's a little more cumbersome than others, other features. Anyway, yeah, thank you for taking the opportunity to have people make public comment. And one thing, I've started reviewing the documents, but like many, it's very imposing when they arrive just right before the holidays. And I'm not sure I've looked at everything in there. In fact, I know I haven't looked at everything in there. But one thing I didn't notice, and I did do a search for, was was there consultation with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Services, National Marine Fisheries, California Department of Fish and Wildlife? You know, I didn't see, sort of extensive discussions or really a report of the discussions and the findings, in particular for Contract 3B and some of the others. I've been very much involved with efforts to preserve the American Parkway. I'm very familiar with Corps of Engineers projects. Since 1989, I've had a construction management consulting business and worked on several Corps projects and worked on several restoration projects. But I really didn't see sort of the depth of analysis from, the National Marine Fisheries and U.S. Fish and Wildlife. I would expect on a river that's a designated, salmon river habitat. So I was wondering if those could be included, and if they are, maybe you could direct me, I made comments to them, maybe direct where those actually are in the report, if they are there.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Marianne? Marianne, I sent you the request to unmute. There you are. I can hear you.
All right. I was in Santa Cruz when the Army Corps of Engineers came along and decided to put in an extension of the harbor. And what they did when they were putting in the extension, all this huge rocks, the surface said, hey, you're doing it the wrong direction. Well, they went ahead with the project because their engineers said it was the right direction. They didn't listen to the comments of the people that actually were in the water every single day. And so what they had to do is they come back every other year and they dredge the harbor to keep the harbor open at a tremendous cost to the boaters and the people of Santa Cruz, and it destroys the beach area. That's just one comment. In 2008, I was a teacher and I was working with students, and I had a visit from the Army Corps of Engineers, and they were talking about how when they decided to do their river control in San Jose, they didn't do the river control properly, and they realized that all of these big pipes that were channeling the water, that on heavy water years, those things got just pushed around in the water and ended up causing more flood damage, and now they had to be removed. And so that was an extra cost. I believe that if this project is allowed to go forward, the cost could be the end of Sacramento having any kind of a designation as a place you want to go to. It won't be a place of trees, because the one area that really is beautiful and has passed all of these stages of time and kind of gives us this wonderful riparian corridor that, it's not just the kids, it's the birds, the animals, and the possibility of controlling some of the heat that goes through this area. And finally, I know that I'm not really connecting my thoughts, but finally, this area, the river has gone through some major stressors. There was this huge storm air surge that we had last year. And before that, there were many years of drought. And there have been lots of fires that have really affected the corridor. So I really feel like the damages have happened, and it's still trying to recover. So this is the wrong time. And that's why I think we need a targeted approach. And thank you for listening.
Thank you, Marianne. Is there anyone else? I don't see that we have any more hands up. Give it another second if anyone has any final thoughts. See. Okay, one last one, Ellen.
Thank you. It was just, there's been a couple of very specific questions asked in the comments that keep coming up. I am wondering if there's anything you can do to get some of these answers for the next meeting on the 16th.
I see another hand up. So once we're done with this, we're going to pull this entire chat off and we'll start going through it. The next meeting's on the 16th, which doesn't give us a lot of time to be able to answer all these questions. We're going to prioritize people who like need help getting access to a resource in order to provide like a full written comment. So that's what we're going to start with. And then our plan is to provide full responses after that public comment period ends, which is right now February 5th.
But how can we make a full comment without having these questions answered?
Yeah.
Because you're saying that we don't get the answers to our questions until after we've submitted our comments.
Oh, sorry. I might be misunderstanding and it's a little hard. I haven't been able to monitor the chat. Well, there's other people monitoring the chat right now. So people who have asked questions, we're going to still consider anything in the chat as a part of the public record. So that will still go into our comment matrix that will be responded to after the public comment period ends. Okay. Just like everything that's been verbalized. But right now, before you're asking before the 16th, we're not going to be able to respond to all of these. We'll do our best to, if there's something, you know, you want to find this document that was listed as a citation, you can't find it yourself, things like that, we'll do our best to get to you as soon as we can before the public comment period ends.
So there isn't any way to have any real communication, just how to get comments. That's what this meeting is. Clarifying.
There's a lot of comments. There's a lot of things in the chat. Without like seeing the specific one, I can't say that I can answer all of these right now, you know, but we want to make sure that you can provide, you have everything you need to provide a full written comment, as much information as you need to get that done. That's what we want to provide to you. Okay. All right. I see like there's more hands up. So I can only stand for 15 more minutes. With the rest of my crew. So I am going to move on to MB Schuer.
The Army Corps makes mistakes. I don't want to.
MB Schuer, Schweher. Okay, I've sent you a request to unmute.
Ah, there we go. Now, I think finally it let me unmute.
Okay, gotcha.
It was telling me I could not unmute myself.
Sorry about that.
My name is Mary Beth Schwer. I'm a 35-year plus resident in the 3B South Project area. I'm on the board of our Townhouse Association, a couple of master's degrees from UC Berkeley. I have a career of 35 plus years in the technical field of air pollution, writing regulations and protecting the public from toxics, and including cancer-causing diesel exhaust and risk assessment. And I want to comment on the disproportionately high risks that children face when exposed to toxics. So I really question the disproportionate lifetime risk that's being added to the K-6 children at Earlywine School, right next to the Larchmont staging area of the heavy diesel equipment. I also don't think I saw use of California's diesel cancer potency factor, which is actually higher than what you get using EPA's. I agree with most of the comments that I've heard today already. I truly derive my sustenance from my daily time on the river. It has astonishing wilderness level natural attributes and wildlife. People are amazed to find that they survive here. And I'm very concerned about this character even surviving with this extended creep of destruction into the wildlife corridor. My home's an immediately adjacent property to this project on South Bank of 3B Reach 41. I absolutely care about flood safety, but I assure you from everything I've seen, I will feel much less safe if the interwoven renewable natural armoring network that protects the bank all the way down from the water's edge, all the way up to the top, is replaced with buried rocks on top, with poor soil on top and a planting bench. There are a lot of big downsides to launchable rock tows. There can be issues of scouring at the ends, so the project links miles of them together, which then means you need big earth moving equipment and more rocks, which means bigger trucks, which means staging areas next to schools and haul roads that damage roads and levees. And the worst part is that the planting benches are on the same foundation, so if the launchable rocks ever do need to launch, we will lose the planting bench with them. And in a prior project, the Corps was asked, would that be repaired? And there has not been an answer yet to anyone's knowledge. Being here over 35 years, I've lived through a lot of atmospheric rivers and high flows, and our levees and riverbanks have had no issues even before all the additional fortification of slurry walls that go down 60 feet deep inside the levees and all the great improvements that allow Folsom Dam to manage the whole atmospheric river situation so much better. They can release water soon ahead of time when we can see storms coming. It's so much more improvement than that has already been done. There doesn't seem to be any need here for this. It doesn't make sense. Some of the Army Corps projects in the larger area did make sense, but not here. I do want to commend your environmental team for trying to do damage control, but I think you've been handed a raw deal by higher decisions that really are trying to do one size fits all and overgeneralized data. It just doesn't make sense to do miles of bulldozing in a stretch of river that might have at most a couple spots. This stretch is truly different than other project areas elsewhere in Sacramento. I just don't see the compelling need here. If you don't have to be a scientist to look at the data. The Corps' own captions on the figures say, seepage, no problem here. These launchable rock tows haven't even been time tested in the other areas yet. So we don't even know for sure how they will fare in our river environment. And now we're continuing them before we even know that. The SES is a bit of a catch-all. I just don't see that this makes sense here. I also want to mention that the 2011 revetment has not come back after 13 years looking anything like the mix of species that was there before. And I will point out that your access ramps were in an earlier map, and we're being told that they're not going to be available in the draft environmental document, but those access ramps themselves threaten a number of prime heritage oaks and a number of other trees. So how can we evaluate a project that doesn't have the results of the access ramps? We're told that they would not appear in probably until the final SES, which is outside of the public comment period. So I really appreciate your time. I understand you guys have a tough job to do. I think we need to have these meetings, in-person meetings with the engineers who are actually making some of these decisions. And I encourage you to pull out some of those upper subcomponents on the east end of Contract 3B South that just don't really make any sense. It's a straight stretch of river, low flow velocities, no seepage data that shows any concern. And do surgical kind of approaches in a few places if ever needed. Thank you for your time.
So do we have any other questions?
Oh, yes. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Jamie, Jamie Becker. I live in Contract 3B against the levee. And this is going to be pretty short, sweet, and to the point. And I second everyone's comments here. And also, probably everyone else feels the same. I'm not only concerned, but I'm outraged by the idea of this plan and project. Does everyone remember 2020? I know it seems like it was so long ago, but not so long ago. But this was a refuge. The river was a refuge for people. I mean, we were all stuck in our houses. To be able to get out and go to the river and utilize it for not only mental health, you know, recreation, and it's my sanctuary. I use that river constantly. I'm out there. So that's my short and sweet statement. And I'm pretty sure everyone else feels the same way.
Thank you. I see one more hand up, Brenda Gustin. I will put that through again.
Thank you. Now I got it. Thank you. Thank you, Kaylee. You're on the first line tonight, kind of the front line. Don't know if you expected to hear so many people. And I am completely impressed with the talent, the expertise that is present here on the call. And I hope that the core can see this. So I think that a really great approach on a just a pragmatic way is for you to, of course, look at all these questions, yet also by next Tuesday at the meeting, have the court, if possible, through your process, decide to extend the periods here, because the people here that have all this expertise and knowledge that are locals really need to be heard and be participating in this project. I'm a native Sacramentan and lived here. We have, you know, the 100-year floodplain, the 200-year floodplain. There's many, many ways to, you know, care for this area. We're dealing with climate change that is unprecedented. And I just don't see that this project is really going to help what we don't know is coming. So not one of those experts, but I sure do honor all the people that are here. And I support the public being participants in this. So thank you for making it possible. And I hope you'll make it more possible for us to be involved. Thank you.
Thanks, Brenda. So I'm going to take one last comment from Pete, and then I want to have just kind of 5 minutes to wrap it up. Okay. So I'm going to unmute you, Pete.
Okay. I figured that out this time. I want to expand on what Brenda just said. You know, naturally, we've been spreading the word about these meetings tonight and next week. For next week's meeting, it would be great if there could be some of the technical people from the Corps on board. And maybe an open question to you, Kaylee, can you give us any guidance? We don't want to, at least I don't want to repeat the same thing next week that I said tonight. I'll have other things to delve into by then, but can you give us any guidance on next week, or can you kind of really encourage the Corps to get some technical folks on to listen to concerns directly? And I'll leave it at that. And thanks a lot. I know you're working late tonight, and we appreciate it.
Thanks, Pete. Yeah, so I did want to discuss the plan for the 16th. It is going to be set up in a similar way. So we are going to have that pre-recorded presentation, and then we are going to be open for public participation just like this today. So if you have something new that comes up that you want to discuss, pop on and feel free to comment. We're going to take everything in the chat. Everything in the chat, you know, is recorded. This will be included as a, you know, an official comment. All of this record will be. All of the verbal comments that we've heard today, we will transcribe these. We've taken notes. We have a participation list. But yeah, we do. We would, you know, some of these are written, you know, you're writing kind of quick. So if you want to send us to our email addresses, we have those. I don't know if we still have the slides up, but we could post, I could
just type them in the chat if that's helpful for those of you still on those email addresses. And we'll do our best to answer questions if you need help finding something. If you can't find, you're interested in, say, you know, noise near your house, you're interested in a staging area, hall route, dust. You know, I've heard a lot of concerns about habitat impacts, wildlife impacts, mitigation. If you need help finding something like that, we will do our best to answer you as quick as we can. I don't think that we have your emails and stuff like that from this meeting. So if you want like an email response clarification, you know, that's when you're going to email. Can some guys in the background put those emails in the chat right now for USACE and for DWR. We've been receiving your comments. There is an automatic response that's going out right now. Just so you know that we got it, okay? It's not answering a question that's substantive, that requires, you know, a lot of effort, and it requires the whole, our whole PDT, our whole team to respond to. So if you get that automatic response, it's not trying to be dismissive. It's just trying to make sure you know that we got it, okay? And it's recorded. Is there anything else that I'm missing, guys? Bailey? And maybe,
I'm working on getting the emails in. I'm trying to make sure I grab the right ones.
Okay, perfect. I wouldn't recommend putting anything private in the chat, you know, like your home address or anything like that. As we wrap up here tonight, but definitely, yeah, you can put your email address. I don't think anything's gonna blow up like that from other people. So thank you for your time. It's been a long night. We really appreciate and we really value all of your comments. You've had a lot of great comments. We are considering all of them. We're considering all the written comments that we've gotten in our emails. We have seen a lot of, you know, requests for extension. We heard a lot of that tonight. We are considering that, but it's not just, you know, my decision. It goes way up high. It's across our sponsors and it's a NEPA and a CEQA issue. So any updates will be on the website, sacleveupgrades.com. We can put that in the chat as well. I think that's all that I have. Thank you guys so much. It's almost 8 p.m. It was nice to see your faces.